Dude, hello everyone. Hi, so good to be here with you. It's a privilege to be able to share this morning from God's Word, and I'm excited to do that. We're going to jump right in because we have a lot to cover. We will be participating in communion at the end of the service, so if you didn't get one of these little cups on your way in, I think they're located by the door still. Send someone from your row, be like, just go get me one of those cups, bro. And make sure you have one of those. But let's jump right in. Paige, she was just up here, but she didn't mention the really good news that happened this week in our house. Our Christmas present finally arrived. I don't know if it was shipping delays and all that stuff, but our Apple TV finally showed up. And I got to tell you guys, I'm just going to be real with you. As I opened up the box and I set that thing up, a little mini worship service broke out in the living room. I was like, God, thank you so much. This is amazing. Everything about it was so easy to set up. And the thing I was dreading, to be honest, the thing I was dreading about it was having to redo all your passwords and type in passwords and email addresses, logins with a tiny little clicker. It takes forever, right? If you ever get logged out of your Netflix on your Apple TV, you're just like, oh, I don't care about Netflix anymore. I'm not going to type in my email address and password. It takes 3 years to. Anyways, I've got things I'm working through with that. All that to say, the experience of setting up this new Apple TV was just complete. It was amazing. My phone recognized it and said, just poke this button, and it just talked, and it played so nicely with my phone. And I was like, I was just standing there. I'm like, can I help? Are you guys just, you guys are taking care of it? Okay. And just did all, it was just amazing. I love it. It was like that. And this is not a promotion for Apple, okay? This is just me recognizing like how advanced technology has become and how smart humans are. I was just like, humans are awesome. I mean, we do a lot of stupid things, but this was an awesome thing that we did. And whoever created this thing, this technology, we need to find out who this person is and give them a prize. They deserve something for this work that they've done. It was just amazing. So we've come a long way since, you know, the TV with the bunny ear antennas. I mean, I'm dating myself here a little bit, okay? So students, young people in the room, just, you know, I've heard that there's these things that used to exist. But people would, you know, the bunny ear antennas trying to get the TV channel to show up on the TV. I remember being a really young kid and seeing my dad spend like hours with that thing just trying to get it in the right position. So, hold, no, don't move. Just try. And there was always duct tape and tinfoil involved. So, but I appreciate that because it just shows how far we've come. It's crazy how our knowledge as, you know, as humans has come so far. And in our lifetime, we've seen a lot of discoveries that have really changed the way that we live. The thing is though, it seems to me as our knowledge of the natural world, as our knowledge of this world has increased, it almost seems like there's been a decrease of our knowledge and understanding of the spiritual world. You see, as our knowledge has increased, it seems like there's been an exponential increase of knowledge out here, the seen world out here. It seems like there's also been a corresponding decrease of knowledge of the world in here, the internal realm. So for many people, especially I'd say for many Christians, we're really clueless as to what's going on in here. I mean, we know as Christians, we know like the right behaviors, the right attitudes and actions that we are supposed to have, but we don't know what we are or who we are in here. And so we spend our lives really trying out here, living a life out here in the external that we don't even believe is true and consistent about us on the internal. And that just sets us up for a lot of frustration and failure. And that really is what we call like living from the outside in. And what we want to look at in this series is what does it look like to live from the inside out? We've got to know what's underneath the surface. I came across a story not too long ago. I want to share it with you. A guy named Ira Yates, owned a dry goods store in West Texas in 1915, which he traded to a guy named Thomas Hickox for a large cattle ranch in a nearby county. Despite Ira's experience raising cattle, his ranch struggled financially. One day, though, on a hunch, He invited the Transcontinental Oil Company to explore his land for oil. The drillers hit the richest oil deposit found in the state of Texas up to that time. Ira Yates, his financial troubles were solved in a single day, and the Yates oil field is still producing oil decades later. And the next day, the local newspaper headlines proclaim the news: Yates becomes millionaire overnight. Okay, that's a true story, but let me ask this question. Is that a true headline? We had this conversation with our young adults, and it broke out into a very vicious debate. Katie knows. But since I'm the one speaking, I get to be right on this one, okay? And I have a point to make. So it's a true story, but is it a true headline? Well, no. It's not a true headline. The truth is that Mr. Yates became a millionaire the very moment that he took ownership of that cattle ranch. He just didn't know it. And I can't help but to see this as, you know, as a picture of so many of us today, that we walk around with no idea what's under the surface, or under the surface, what is true about us on the inside, what is true about us, what is already ours, what we already possess by virtue of being a child of God. And so if we don't know what is already true about us at the core of our being, if we don't know that there's been a radical transformation that has taken place at the core of our being because of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus, I mean, we will spend our lives, every waking moment, living our life with as being spiritually broke and bankrupt, trying desperately to get what we already possess, trying to get more acceptance, trying to get more love, trying to get more forgiven, trying to be more holy, trying to get more righteous, trying to get cleaner, trying to get closer to God. And like a dog chasing its tail, we can spend so much of our lives trying to catch and keep what already belongs to us. So it's entirely possible for here, you in the room, watching on the plaza, watching online, it's entirely possible for you to be saved, forgiven, to be a new creation, to be completely righteous and holy, going to heaven and all that. All of that, it's entirely possible for all of that to be 100% completely true about you right now, and for you to be miserable, for you to be distracted, confused, deceived. Both of those things are possible. Proverbs 23:7, it says this: "For as a man thinks within himself, so he is." As a man thinks within himself, so he is. You see, it's actually really important what we think about. What we think about, what we know. You can see from that verse that what we believe to be true about us is crucial, that what we believe to be true about us and God, that will determine how we live, how we act, how we relate to other people and to God and to ourselves. And so you see, healthy living begins with healthy beliefs. Healthy living is rooted in a healthy and true view of who we are in Christ. And so a question that we should all really be asking and to be honest about with ourselves is, what or who is the source the source of my thoughts and my ideas that are shaping my perception of reality? Who is the source of the thoughts and the ideas that help me to make decisions about how to relate with God and with and myself and with others? What is shaping my understanding? Is it the world and all of that it offers and how the world operates, or is it the Word of God? What is shaping my understanding? And by God's grace and His Spirit, what we're going to do over the next 4 or so weeks, we're going to detox. We're going to detox. You know, it's a new year. Many of you might be on a detox of your own, but, you know, a detox is that thing that we do to rid our body of toxins and unhealthy things. And spiritually speaking, I'd say that all of us at some level are in need of a spiritual detox. You see, there's a lot of bad, faulty, flawed, toxic things and ideas that we have been taught or we believe or that just have lived with us so long, we just think of them as true. We don't check them. We just assume them. And perhaps we are in our need of that same detox of all of those things that are not based upon the truth of God's word. And so wherever you're at this morning, wherever you're at, whatever you're facing, and let's be real. I mean, I've had the conversations. I mean, many of us are experiencing a lot of pain, a lot of darkness, a lot of depression, fatigue, just blahness. A lot of us are maybe feeling the crippling anxieties and fears, and we're paralyzed with different things and like the pain of our, there's so many things that we could just list, go on and on and on. I mean, even just the last several weeks, the amount of stories I've heard about marriages that are on the rocks, and just all of the stuff, wherever you're at, whatever it is you're facing, we need to know that there is hope, that there's hope for us. And so over the next few weeks, we're actually going to be getting into a lot of more of the specifics of these things, specifics of some of the things that we are facing and feeling. But today what I wanted to start out is Ryan and I, we talked about this sermon series and stuff. I'm like, Ryan, you got to let me go first. Let me be the leadoff batter. I'm so excited to share what I'm going to share today. I'm so excited to share this with our church family. I'm like, let me be the leadoff batter. So if you don't like it, just blame him for letting me do this, okay? Just a little caveat there. But our prayer is that the truth would set us free. The truth that we discover. You know, what I want to do in today, I want us to drill down. I want us to drill down into that, get that gospel oil that is sitting there below the surface, that is already ours. It's already yours. It's already true about you. I want us to tap into that and to discover the riches of God's grace that are yours and mine right now, and that truth would set us free. It would set us free to live our lives from the inside out. So what I want to do today is we're going to do a little educational system here. I got my little friendly whiteboard up here. And I want to share two tools with you, okay? These are just tools, the things that God has used in my own life. It's been extremely helpful in helping me just to kind of visualize and to see what we mean by our identity in Christ and stuff. So I just want to share two tools with you. Don't worry, those of you over here, we're going to put me up on the Jumbotron. There I am. Okay? There we are. So two tools that I want to share with you today. The first one is called The Line, and this has been extremely helpful for me. It's called The Line. See? Isn't that helpful? It's great. The Line. If you have your Bibles, open up to 2 Corinthians 4:18. 2 Corinthians 4:18. The Apostle Paul, he writes this. We look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Again, I want to just read that again. We look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Okay, so what's up with the line? What Paul is doing here is he's really giving us, he's identifying there's two different realms that exist. Up above the line, we have the unseen and eternal. And below the line, we've got the seen and temporal. Okay, so in reality, let's just call this out. In reality, there's no such thing as the line, right? But this is just helping us to, I mean, because we think in terms of concepts, and a lot of us are visual, it just helps us to be able to parse these out, to see them, to separate them. So we've got the line there. Okay, so you and I, you know, right now, here now, like we exist, we conduct our lives in the seen and the temporal. I mean, this is the realm of material, physical, time and space, things below here, below the line, in the seen and temporal realm always are incomplete. They're always in process, always kind of fluctuating and moving around. So it's the, you know, there's sowing and there's reaping, There's birth and death. There's all kinds of starts and all kinds of finishes. You know, we know that this realm had a beginning. And we know, according to Scripture, that this realm, this world, has an end. And if Paul uses language to describe, between these two lines here, he calls it this age. It's this age that we are existing in. So there's a beginning, there's an end. We had a beginning. You guys are here. Happy birthday, if I didn't say it to you last year. You had a beginning. And, spoiler alert, you're going to have an end. Okay? Some of you might be right. No. Okay. Some of us, we've placed our faith in Christ, and you had a Christian beginning. And so we'll put that there. Okay, so you see there's a lot of beginnings and there's a lot of endings in this realm. There was a start to this age. There was a start of my physical life. There was a start to my spiritual life, my Christian life. And then there's an end of my physical life and an end of my Christian life as far as the seen and temporal is concerned. And then there's the end of this age. And so, so this realm is bound by time. Now, the unseen and the eternal realm, the time does not exist up in the unseen and the eternal realm. And so there's not going to be there's no vertical lines up here. The realm of unseen and eternal is changeless. It's timeless. And really the unseen and eternal realm could be best illustrated with the word now. I mean, to God, things are now. Things are now. He's not sitting around and waiting for something to happen. Things are now. This is the realm of ultimate reality, where everything is finished, everything is settled. This is ultimate reality. And it's really important for us to understand, too, that we're not talking about some kind of Greek dualism or Gnosticism, where we talk about the spiritual is what's really, really good, and that's what we need to focus on, and this is all bad, the physical. We're not doing that. Both of these realms are very, very important to God. He created these realms. What we are doing is that we are acknowledging what Paul is saying. He's saying there's two different realms. There's the unseen, there's the seen, and one of them is more important, that you and I, we are to focus on the eternal, the unseen. And so really, many ways, and throughout Scripture, you're going to see that we live, our lives, we live above and below the line. And throughout Scripture, you're going to see different truths, and it's going to feel confusing at times, which is why I think this helps. Hebrews 10:14 says this, and there's a lot of verses that are like this. Hebrews 10:14, "For by one offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified." So if you're paying attention to that, like, it's kind of like almost feeling like it's saying two different things, right? By one offering he's perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And so if you've ever read a verse like that and felt a little confused, you're in good company, because me too. So he's made me perfect. I've been made perfect, but I'm still being sanctified. I'm imperfect, but I'm still being made holy. Which one is it? Like, tell me who I am. Which one is it? Again, this is important. That's why this helps, the line helps make sense of this. You see, in the internal and the unseen realm, you and I, we have been made perfect forever. We've been made perfect forever. And what's really cool about that, when God saved us, when he accomplished his work, we also find out that he made us complete. Colossians 2. That's exciting, so we're going to put an exclamation mark. Maybe a couple. I'm an exclamation mark guy. We've been made righteous. He became sin so that we might become his righteousness. Colossians 1 talks about us being holy, blameless. You see, these are the truths that are, this is ultimate reality. This is what is true about you and I. If you're in Christ, this is what's true about you. Not when you get your act together, not when you even finally understand it, not even when you decide to believe it. It's already, this is what's true about you. These truths are true above the line. And so for the Christian, we need to understand that the truest and the realest you, the realest you exists above the line, that you are fully complete, fully righteous, holy, blameless, that, I like this one, that, because I don't often feel this, you're a finished product. And let's just go ahead and write perfect on here. You're a finished product. You're not becoming. You're not growing. You're not changing. There's actually nothing that's happening. You're not transforming. You simply are. In the eternal and unseen world, these are unchanging truths. They're true about you right now. They're according to God. This is true now. Now. And so above the line, this is where our ultimate reality is. This is where our ultimate, our identity is anchored. And we are safe. Our identity is safe. It's fixed. It's secure. Below the line, however, let me erase these little guys. Below the line, this is where we experience life, right? This is why it might be even hard for us to even understand how this can be true when this is happening. Below the line, what we experience is that we are in process. And sometimes that process is not fun. Sometimes it's confusing. But we are in process. We are in the process of being sanctified in our minds, in our attitudes, our actions. There's a process that is happening. Down below the line, we experience all kinds of, that says F-L-U-C, for fluctuating. Just to be clear there. Fluctuating emotions. Our emotions can be all over the place, can't they? We are experiencing change. Sometimes that change is good. Sometimes it's bad. There's growth. There's incompleteness. There's, I will say, progress, but also setbacks. This could be happening outside of us in the world. This could be happening inside. I mean, we experience all different kinds of stuff. And so where this up here is fixed, it's complete, it's finished, it's unchanging, down here we experience all different kinds of stuff. It's constantly changing. But we need to know that you and I, as believers, we are not below the line people. We live below the line, but we are above the line. That's where we live. You see, even in 1 Peter, it talks about us being strangers, being aliens in this world, in this age, that we are strangers and aliens. You see, no, we are of God's kingdom. We're born from above. We're born of the Spirit. Look at John 3, Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus. It's all about being born of the Spirit up there. And so you and I, we don't look to below the line. We don't look to that to give us and provide for us our identity, for our significance and our meaning, to feel anchored. No, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Okay, so that's the line. Okay, next, that's tool number one. Tool number two is called the swing. The swing, again, this is just a tool that the Holy Spirit has used to help for me to understand my identity in Christ, understanding my truest identity. So whereas the line separates and makes the distinction between the unseen and the seen, the swing, it draws a distinction between body, soul, and spirit. So let me ask you this. Did you know that you are a three-part person? You're a three-part person. So think about it. Just like God is a triune being, one God comprised of three persons, man is, in a way, is a triune being as well. We are one person with three parts, body, soul, and spirit. And it's really important that we know that and we understand what the differences are between those. One of the verses where we see this three-part person clearly laid out is in 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, there's a lot that we could say about that verse. There's a lot there, but what I want us to just notice is that we are three parts. that there's three parts to us. And so we're not just two, but we are three. And most of us in here, we'll acknowledge we're at least two, right? I mean, okay, we have a body. You know, we see our bodies, we look in the mirror, we see our bodies, we make observations, we make judgments about our bodies. We feed our bodies, we exercise them, we give them rest, we watch our bodies as we get older, we watch them age and things change. Our five senses help connect us. It helps connect us to the world, the material, the physical world, our five senses. You know, touch, taste, hearing, seeing, and smelling. And for some of us, maybe for some reason we recently lost our smell and our taste. I don't know. It's weird, right? It's weird. It's strange. And when you lose your senses, you're one of your five or two, like when you lose any of your five senses, you feel disconnected from the world. So we understand body, but we are also aware that there's something more going on. I'm not just a body that's floating or walking around and interact. There's something else going on inside. After all, I have a lot of thoughts. I have emotions. I have feelings. We think, we process, we reflect, we experience a lot of emotions and rejection and wounding and joy. I mean, there's all different kinds. There's stuff that's going on inside. So what is that? Well, I would say that's the function of our soul. That's the function of our soul. See, the Greek word used for soul is a word psyche, which is where we get our science of psychology, which studies the relationship of the mind, the mind, the will, the emotions that are within us. And so you could say a kind of a catchy way to think about it with the soul contains our thinker, our feeler, and our chooser. We think, we feel, we choose. The soul is also home to our personality. Every single one of us is uniquely different. None of us are exactly the same. And so it's in our soul that we have our unique personality, and we have like the extroverts, we have the introverts, we have all the whole gamut. We've got people who are more like rational and objective and led by the mind. There's people who are more subjective and they're led by feelings. And a lot of times these two people get together, fall in love, and get married. So we know that we're body, we know that we're soul. We know that we're at least two parts, and for many people, that's really as far as they go. That's as far as they go. It's as deep as they go. But we need to recognize that we are a three-part being. We have a spirit, and that our spirit is different than our soul. So a lot of times, it's so easy just to conflate it all. Since it's all inside, just conflate it all, and then there's no distinction. But I love what Hebrews 4:12 says. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, even penetrating as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. So soul and spirit. If we were to put you onto a spiritual operating table, and we were to cut you open, what would we see? Well, we'd cut open your body. We'd see your soul, but if we kept opening you up, we would see spirit. We would see that you also have a spirit. So we know body, we know soul, but what is our spirit? And our spirit really is the core, the absolute core of our being, the very center of our being. Our spirit is the truest us. It's your true self. It's the deepest part of who you are, your deepest identity. And so we could wrap it all together and put it this way, that we are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live in a body. We are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live in a body. You see, we are a three-part person. We're a three-part person in our daily lives, as believers, in our daily lives, down here, below the line, in the seen and the temporal, one of the most important things that we could understand and grasp, one of the most important things is that above the line, that we and God are one, and we are one in spirit. So, this is our spirit. I'm just going to put God. That we are one, that there's union there. 1 Corinthians 6:17, it says, he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. He who's joined the Lord is one spirit with him. You see, at salvation, God gives you a new spirit. He promised to do this. In the Old Testament, he's like, I'm going to put my spirit in them. I'm going to give them a new heart, a new spirit. God gave you a new spirit. You see, we are all born into this world with a spirit. Everyone has one. But we are born into this world with a spirit that is dead to God and alive to sin. And what happens at salvation is God, he gives you a new spirit. He crucifies the old one. It's dead, buried, gone. He gives you a new spirit that is alive to God and dead to sin. Newness. And so, and know that this up here, this is union. We are fused. We are united. We are joined to God. Our spirit is. It's just like a cup of tea. When you put that little tea bag in your cup, all of a sudden the tea starts to diffuse out. At that point, it's the point of no return, right? There's no way for us to separate them out again. They become one. There's no way for us to tell where the tea ends and the water begins. It's all one. And so it's important for us to understand that our spirit exists above the line in the unseen and eternal realm where things simply are. Things are, and they are now. It doesn't fluctuate. Our union with God doesn't fluctuate. You know, it's not fickle and capricious and all over the place. To God, it's now, and it doesn't change, does not fluctuate. And this provides an amazing, amazing anchor for our swing. Give me a moment. The seat of the swing, that is carrying us through this seen and temporal world as our body, and we're going to put our soul right there on top, going, wee. So notice that our soul and our body exist in the seen and the temporal world. Yes, hear me on this, our soul is eternal, our soul is going to heaven. But right now, it exists and it functions below the line. And unlike the realm of the spirit, where everything is fixed and finished and unchanging, everything seems to be changing down here below the line, right? I mean, our soul experiences changes all the time. It just depends on what's the latest thought or feeling that enters into our mind and our heart, our soul. Like there's constant changing and shifting. There's so much fluctuation. And so we fluctuate between a lot of good thoughts, good feelings, good, good, good vibrations, and bad. Boo. And guys, we are constantly swinging. I mean, if you think about a swing, too, and when you sit down on a swing, all of the movement is where you are, right? You're sitting down, the movement is happening all here. All the movement and the activity. And it's anchored into a place that's not moving, it's not shifting. May have a little squeak, you know, some of those swings need some help, a little WD-40. But the same thing is true for us spiritually, is that down here, we exist down here. All of this activity, all of the movement happens down here, our body and our soul. But we have to know that we are anchored up there. We can be all over the place. But if we do not know, if we don't know that we are spirit, then the soul activity is going to be what dominates and controls our life. Going to control us. If we don't know spirit, then all we know in us is our wild and crazy swinging soul. And let's be honest here. I mean, we don't like our swings to swing, do we? No. Or we like our swings to swing, but we want to keep it up here, right? Just keep it up here and somehow can we just keep my swing on the good side? I love the good feelings. I love the good thoughts. I love the joy. I love all the good stuff. And when we're over here, it's just like, I hate this. It's so bad. And we start questioning everything. And there's all just different kinds of mess. And we want to stay in the good. Or we think, God, he wants me to get my swing under control. So therefore, I'm going to try to stop my swing. I'm going to stop it. I want to keep it right there in the middle, under control. And if you listen to the way that we talk sometimes, we Christians talk, it's almost as though we define Christian maturity as getting your swing under control. Like, stop your swing. I'm not supposed to have swinging activity and stuff. Like, I want to just keep it. I want to be steady. I want to be confident and be just like, you know, I want to be solid. And so we just want to stay right there. What if God, though, is not trying to stop your swing? What if his plan was that your swing would swing? What if he's the one who put your swing into motion? See, the swinging of our souls, friends, is a part of God's plan. I mean, what's the purpose of a swing anyways? To swing. If I was to put Archer, our son, into a swing and say, don't swing, like, that just wouldn't happen. Maybe like 32 seconds would go by. I mean, he's sitting in a swing, it's meant to swing. Okay, so we have to know that the feelings and the thoughts and the experiences, good or bad, everything that happens down here is not the deepest or truest part of who we are. We're not dismissing what happens here. We're not minimizing what's happening here. Nowhere in the Bible does it say ignore the activity of the soul. Not at all. This is about a knowing in the midst of all of this that we know where we are anchored, where our the deeper, more true reality of who we are is taking place. And if all that we know is soul, then we're going to live according to whatever the soul is experiencing. And as we know, it experiences a lot, minute to minute, moment to moment, day to day. It's all over the place. And so living from the inside out, it means that we're living from our spirit, our union with God. That's the place that we're living from, where we are united, where we are fused, where we are one with Jesus Christ. And friends, this is the most surest, strongest, most capable anchor for our soul. Jesus is the anchor of our soul. Hebrews 6 says that. So understanding the distinction between these two realms and the distinction between spirit, soul, and body, I mean, I think it's important, but there's for a lot of different reasons. And it's so hard to even go into all of the nuances and stuff. This is just meant to be an introduction to where we're going in the series, to give us some framework for where we're going, some common language. These distinctions are super important for a lot of reasons, but let me just give you three. First of all, faith. You and I were designed to operate on faith. We're created to operate on faith. God created our souls. This is crazy. He created our souls to be fully capable of experiencing thoughts and emotions that are contrary to this reality, contrary to what is true. Why would he do that? Well, this is the only way that you and I, would learn to live by faith. Learn to live by faith out of who we really are and who God really is. God uses the activity of the swing, all of it, he uses that to really push us back to the core of who we are, living out of our spirit, our union with him, joined to him. So it's just kind of cool that the life below the line provides us the occasion by which our faith can be expressed. If this isn't happening, our faith, the faith in the ultimate reality, there's no way for it to be expressed. And so, friends, I know it can be hard, it can be difficult and painful, and we're not trying to minimize any of that, but this down here is meant to be a place of expression of your safety and your security in Christ, united, bonded, fused to God, and all of the truth that is contained up here. Down here is our opportunity for that to be experienced in the soul and expressed through the body. Galatians 2:20. The verse you hear quite often around here, Katie mentioned it last week, says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Talking about that fusion right there. Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and he gave himself for me. I love how the author, a guy named Dan Stone, he says it here. He says, when we see who we really are in Christ, then we can say, the swinging, the the swing is absolutely necessary in God's scheme of things, because how can the principle of faith operate in me without fluctuations on my soul level? How can faith operate in me if I can't be tempted to have unfaith? And so that's one of the things. This provides the occasion, the opportunity of faith. That's one of the things that these distinctions provide. The other one is identity. You see, as believers, I mean, our failures, our sins, our shortcomings, all of that, our struggles, all that stuff that happens to us below the line, I mean, that is constantly, for me at least, it's constantly confronting me. It's constantly in my face, constantly there. And if we're not drawing our true eternal identity from above the line, from our spirit that is bonded, infused, and united to God, then we are going to always look to what's happening down here to define who we are and our identity. It's going to be all about the performance that we're doing, or what we've been able to do, or what's happened to us. All of that is going to be what we're drawing our identity from. And we've gotten it backwards. It's almost like we've been duped into thinking that what we do down here, what we do and accomplish, or whatever happens down here, is somehow causing things to change up here. You know, we've gotten it backwards. You see, the reality that happens here in the unseen and the eternal, what is true right now because of what Christ has done in this union that has been formed, that is meant to inform and, again, for us to experience and express that this reality defines and shapes this reality. Again, remember like what we saw in Hebrews 10, that by one sacrifice he's perfected forever those who are being sanctified. You see, above the line, we've already been perfected. Again, we are a finished product. Below the line, he's continuing to bring these realities. God is working to continue to bring these realities. As we set our mind on him, as our minds are renewed with truth, he's bringing these realities into view. It's already here. It's already now. He's bringing that into view. And so yes, let's admit it. We are in process. We are growing. We're learning. We're figuring things out, but let's remember that nothing that we do down here is causing anything to become more true about us up here. It's not causing anything to change up above the line. Well, that's identity. And thirdly, finally, it's fulfillment. I think that this distinction helps us understand God's plan for us was never that we would find our true lasting fulfillment below the line. In the seen and the temporal. There's a lot of amazing things down here, a lot of amazing experiences and pleasures and, you know, Apple TVs, and there's all kinds of things down here. But this world, this realm was never ever meant to satisfy. He wants us to understand that the realm, the unseen and the eternal, that is where we find our lasting satisfaction. It doesn't matter how beautiful or even how true things are below the line. Below the line, nothing down here will ultimately satisfy. And I think it's a part of God's plan that he would allow us to become dissatisfied with things down here in order to draw us back to the reality of what's up here, where we find true lasting satisfaction so that we can live from a place of union, live from a place of the source of life. See, true life is found above the line. That life is Christ. He is our life. And so, friends, whatever it is that you're facing, whatever it is that you're feeling here below the line, I want you to know, and may you know, that you have a God who loves you. He died for you, and he didn't just stop there. He united himself to you. He bonded himself to you, to your spirit, and he is, with whatever we're facing here, he is the anchor for our soul. And all of this is possible. All of this is possible. All of this good news that we are looking at is possible because Jesus Christ, he came below the line. He came into the scene. He came into the temporal. He came in and did for us what we could never, ever do for ourselves. He died the death that we deserved. He was buried. He was raised. And we learned from Scripture, from Romans 6 and other places, that when he died, what happened to him on the cross also happened to us. So we've been raised and we've been seated. We've been united to him. But all of this is possible because of what he did. He came below the line. And that, and his activity and his work down here is what we remember and what we celebrate when we take of the Lord's Supper, when we take communion. And so if you got your little, your cups, the elements, go ahead and pull those out. There's some, if you didn't grab one, there's someone located by the door. But Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed and the night that he would be arrested, he gathered his boys together for one last meal. And he took a meal that had been, that for thousands of years had pointed back to a past time in Israel's history. And the Passover, and they've been celebrating that. He took that meal and he said, no. From now on, you're going to do this in remembrance of me. You're going to do it in remembrance of me. Which is crazy to think about. But remember, when we take communion, when we remember what Jesus did, we're not remembering our work. We're not remembering what I've done, good or bad, or what's been done to me. We're remembering what it took to bring us home, to what Jesus did, what he accomplished. You know, even in the Old Testament, under an old covenant, when people would bring their sacrifice to the priest, they had to bring a spotless lamb, without blemish, that they would bring to the priest to be inspected. It wasn't the person who brought it that was being inspected. It was the lamb. It was the sacrifice that was being inspected. But we've somehow made it about me and my, like, how am I doing? But it's never been about us. It's been about the sacrifice. And then you see that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and he's the one that we're inspecting. And his work was perfect. It worked the first time. No repeat needed. And so he took of the bread and he said, this is my body given for you, given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup. He says, this cup is my blood in the new covenant. You see, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. We said this before, but it's not our sincerity. It's not our confession. It's not us feeling really, really bad about what we did that gets us forgiven. No, it's blood. And Jesus shed his blood once and for all. It is finished. And so when we drink of the cup, we're simply agreeing with God. We're saying, thank you for forgiving me once for all. So let's raise our cups and drink to the finished work of Christ. God, we thank you so much, Lord, for your promises. Lord, we thank you for the truth that you have revealed to us, that your Spirit has allowed us to see and to savor. And God, would you just keep doing what you're doing, Lord? I pray that this church, these friends, this family, God, would just continue to understand all that you did, that your cross and the resurrection and that you coming to dwell within us, that all of these things change, radically change our reality here below the line, Lord. May we look to you, the source of life. May we draw our life from you, God, from that union that you have brought us into. We thank you for the work that you did on the cross. I just love that we can take of these little simple little bread and juice and to remember, Lord, not what we've done or what we haven't done, but to remember you and what you've accomplished for us. And that changes everything for us. So thank you so much, God, for these reminders. We love you.